Atheist Nomads, episode 124, news for December 10, 2015.
The podcast you're about to listen to includes cursing and talking about hoo-haws. Please be advised.
We are the Atheist Nomads, bringing you history, science, politics, religion, and interviews with leaders in the atheist community. Not all those who wander are lost. Welcome to another episode of Atheist Nomads. I am Dustin.
I'm Lauren. Hi.
And also joining me as always is Wesley.
Hello, everybody. How you doing?
Shut up, Wesley.
Fuck you.
I snorted.
You did. So how you doing, Wesley?
I'm doing good. There's not even a helium balloon around. How you doing?
It's funny voice day.
Oh, please, no. Not of the day I've had. So I had let it out on the show that, you know, I was interviewing for a position that would and let it out elsewhere. Would have taken me to Seattle. I got the rejection letter today.
They're a bunch of assholes.
So right now I am drinking Boise's Edge Brewing Company Blackwater Imperial Stout. This is one with alcohol levels coming in at 11%. This episode is being recorded a week early.
Yeah, fucking hella late. Hella early.
Yeah, because the day this is released, Lauren and I will be at the end of our Cancun honeymoon trip.
Woo!
Woo, woo, woo!
Which makes the topic of Adventist missions especially poignant because...
They're going to be doing missionary position.
I've been to Cancun twice before. Both were for mission trips. First one was my senior year of high school. We did a senior class mission trip in Cancun, building a church there. And then my after my first year in the seminary, I did a seminary-sponsored trip also to Cancun, preaching evangelistic series.
Not dirty at all. Okay.
And it was four sermons in that I called it quits. And later that day, I had my first beer. And I will very happily be drinking a Dos Equis when we get down there.
I mean, seriously, I think my cousin, I think he got someplace in freaking Minnesota.
Different kind of mission, though. He was
crazy.
There for years.
Yeah.
Because one of the big differences that you'll see is, like, the Mormon idea of missions is you're 18, 19, 20, somewhere around that age.
And know everything.
And you leave for 2 years straight. The Adventist idea of missions is very different. It's spring break trips, summer trips. It's basically vacations where you build a church or help out with an evangelistic series that's happening. If you're studying to be a minister, it's basically a vacation where you get to practice preaching. Well, then there are student missionaries that go for a year to work at some institution somewhere. So they're either... usually teaching English in a developed country or teaching elementary, middle, or high school in a developing country. And then you have the actual career missionaries who go after they already have set life skills, and they go and they spend a lot of time usually working at a Adventist institution. My father in the 1960s spent 4 years as a missionary in Guatemala. He was there as a the handyman and mechanic on site, and his wife was the nurse. And for 4 years, they were there at this Adventist mission that had a school, a clinic, and after they left, the house that my dad had built down there became the orphanage. And so that's the kind of stuff that Adventist missions are. It's not like this weird Mormon thing where you just walk around the streets, or the Jehovah's Witness thing where... You spend a couple hours every week knocking on doors. It tends to be either awesome vacations or long periods of time out doing things.
So, quick question.
Mm-hmm.
Was your dad's house really big or was the orphanage really small?
It started out in that house, which was pretty small.
Okay.
They outgrew it within a few years and had to build a new, bigger one. He still has the... 13th Sabbath slideshow presentation on mission work in Guatemala that had, or actually might have just been the orphanage organization, that had a house, a picture of the house that he'd built. And 13th Sabbath for the Adventist Church is, you know, there's four of those per year, and that's when they do special mission-only offerings. So all the offerings collected around the world for that weekend all go to help support mission work. And where all that mission work started was with J.N. Andrews. This is the man that Andrews University is named after, which is the current home of the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary. And he was the Adventist pastor who connected the two-horned beast of Revelation with the United States.
Yeah.
You know, I really should get back to some of that crazy prophecy stuff. But anyway, a bit later, he decided, and the church decided, it was time to send him off as the church's first official missionary. So he went to Switzerland in 1874 to open up a publishing house. Within a few years, within 2 years, he actually started publishing a magazine in French there. And has been heralded ever since as the first missionary for the Adventist Church. One of the next big missionary endeavors was in 1876 with Pitcairn Island. This was the home of the children and grandchildren of the survivors of the Mutiny on the Bounty. And two Adventist pastors put together a bunch of tracts and other reading materials, put them in a box, gave them to a sea captain to take to them in 1876. And the Pitcairn people read through them and were not convinced.
There's a shock.
They were happy with their Church of England beliefs that they had. Then in 1886, John T. Lay, an Adventist layman, so not a minister, was told by his doctor that he needed to go someplace with better air quality. And he'd worked on the sea all of his life and had heard about Pitcairn Island, decided he'd go there. And so he did. He went to Pitcairn and studied and prayed for 5 weeks with the Pitcairners. And at the end of his stay, a lot of them said they want to be baptized. And he told them he wasn't an ordained minister, so he couldn't. So
he should have just taken the money. So he's like, yeah, dunk your head here. Okay, yeah, that'll be $20.
So he promised he'd come back with the pastor. And in 1890, he did. And they'd actually built a mission boat to spread the Adventist message throughout the Pacific Islands. And they named it the Pitcairn. Their first stop was Pitcairn Island. And they baptized a number of Pitcairners. Within a few years, a number had decided it was time to leave the island on mission service. And ever since, the Adventist Church has used Pitcairn Island as this special shining light of what an Adventist world could be like. Because since shortly after that happened, the conversion started, the entire island was Adventist. And they closed down all their businesses on Saturday to worship the Sabbath. And in 2004, they started some sexual assault trials against 7 men living on the island and another 6 that were living abroad. That's a full third of the adult male population.
Well, we know what they were doing Saturday.
Oh, they'd probably wait until Sunday for that.
Oh, true.
6 of the men were convicted, and they all lost their appeals. This was a big enough deal the British government had to set up a prison on the island.
Wow, that's sad. There you go. Here's your Adventist prison.
Great. Jeez. So they actually have the highest in prison per capita of any place in the world now.
Oh, they were actually all released by 2010, and are now going through home detention. So they have the highest per capita amount of sexual offenders, highest per capita amount of pedophiles, and the highest per capita amount of people under home arrest.
Oh, so it was kids.
And
kind of sounds like the Catholic Church.
And the highest per capita place of Adventists.
There you go. Wraps it up into a pretty package.
Yeah, yeah.
A beacon, a shining beacon for the
world. Yes.
That is kind of cool.
I guess you could say it's a paradise lost. Ooh, literary joke.
So that wraps up kind of the historical look at it. But what's going on currently with Adventist missions is generally two main styles. There is the official work, and then there are self-supporting ministries. And then I guess there's two other styles that fit with both of those. So with the official stuff, you'll have conferences and schools, Adventist schools, sending out missionaries for short-term missions. So for 1 to 2 week trips to build churches and do evangelistic series, student missionaries to go work in various institutions. And then you'll have the longer-term missions, which is usually centered around an existing Adventist institution. So think hospitals, schools, universities, and you'll have people, in some cases, medical doctors, RNs, master's level teachers that are going out into these places, into the mission field, to work in the developing world. And then you get the self-supporting ministries, organizations like Maranatha, which their big deal is getting retirees to go on vacations and construct steel churches. The entire church can be set up within a week with, I think, 20 people. And all they need to have before they get there is a concrete slab. The problem is in highly humid areas.
No slab.
Those buildings start rusting almost immediately and are barely usable within 20 years. That's why the one I was working on in high school in Cancun, we were pouring concrete. They've been building this church for 2 years, and we helped them finally finish that roof. But that concrete's actually going to last. A steel building there, wouldn't make it 15 years. We're talking Cancun. That's salty air. And then you have Adventist Frontier Missions. They do long-term stuff. So we're talking usually 5 to 20 years in places that do not have Adventists. And if they're really sticking to their rules, places with fewer than 100 Christians. So very remote areas in Africa and places, Muslim-majority areas where it is illegal for them to be there. And they get to try to play the secret agent missionary game where they lead a double life working in a job there and making friends and That's trying creepy. To keep from getting busted by the police.
That's really creepy.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. And so, yeah, that's Adventist missions. They are nowhere near as annoying as Mormon or Jehovah's Witnesses. But yeah, it can get kind of creepy.
But are they really your friend?
All right, we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be back with history.
Atheist Nomads is proudly brought to you by Archway Hosting. Check out their low-price, full-featured hosting solutions at archwayhosting.com. That's A-R-C-H-W-A-Y hosting.com.
Hey, we're also brought to you by listeners just like you. Find out how you can become a patron at patreon.com/atheistnomads. That's patreon.com/atheistnomads. This day in history, the day is December 10th, the year 1520. Martin Luther burns his copy of the papal bull Exsurge Domine outside of Wittenberg's Elster Gate.
Is that a kind of beef?
What?
Bull.
So, let's get some definitions out of the way. So, a papal bull is a particular type of letter that's issued by the Pope of the Catholic Church. And it is named after the lead seal, or the bulla, that was appended to the end in order to authenticate it. Very, very rarely used, it seems. But, in this case, Martin Luther got one. So, Martin Luther, if you're not familiar, was a German a priest, a professor of theology, and a seminal figure in the Protestant Reformation. So, yeah, he kind of pissed the Catholics off, you might say. In this Exsurge Domine, basically, this is kind of funny. Pope Leo X wrote this letter in response to the teachings of Martin Luther, which opposed the views of the Catholic Church. One of the big ones was like buying your way out of purgatory for people, which is kind of weird saying that, but
indulgences.
Martin Luther wrote 95 theses and all of his subsequent writings basically got his ass in trouble by the church. And the Pope tried to make him recant, and basically, Martin Luther told the Pope to basically fuck off by burning that decree right in front of the church.
Mm-hmm.
So, say what you want to about Martin Luther being an asshole and, you know, starting basically the whole Protestant Reformation and, you know, forking the church, but he was still kind of a badass.
Well, when you look at what the Reformation did, was it helped open up the possibility of not being Catholic.
Yeah, yeah.
Period. It was likely a leading contributing factor in the possibility of the Enlightenment happening. And it also forced the Catholic Church to get better. They had to actually start acting like a church and not just being a political player and fundraiser, which is what they'd mostly been up to that point. They had a monopoly, and he challenged that monopoly. He was also a terrible anti-Semite.
Nice.
Nobody's perfect.
He was one of the inspirations for Hitler's anti-Semitism and was frequently quoted by Hitler.
This day in history, the year is 1817, Mississippi becomes the 20th U.S. state. So, Mississippi was the 20th state admitted to the Union, and David Holmes was elected the first governor. Hooray! Plantations were definitely the primary moneymaker in the state, and they formed along major rivers, close to the waterfront transportation routes, of course. This is also where the early towns developed, linked by the steamboats that carried basically everything to and fro. Yeah, and interestingly enough to me, about 90% of the state remained raw and undeveloped during this time. And it wasn't until after the Civil War's Reconstruction era that the backcountry was cleared. And basically that was all done by the freedmen and women. So, yeah, basically if you weren't next to a river, it was all sticks and stones and pretty nasty, supposedly. But, interesting tidbit, on January 9th, 1861, Mississippi became the second state to declare its secession from the Union, and it was definitely one of the founding members of the Confederate States. During the war, Union and Confederate forces struggled over dominance in the Mississippi River, of course, its critical supply routes and commerce. More than 80,000 Mississippians fought in the Civil War, and casualties were extremely heavy for that state. Interestingly, during the post-war period, freedmen withdrew from the white-run churches to set up independent congregations. Southern Baptist churches were quickly created for black congregations, while the African Methodist Episcopal Church and the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church came from other areas to fill in the gaps. They quickly attracted like hundreds of thousands of converts and founded new churches across the South. And man, oh man, just crazy, crazy, crazy little tidbits about that state.
Yeah.
Little tidbits that lead up to a big old mess that it is now.
Yeah.
Yay.
The state that still has the stars and bars in its flag.
Well, and lowest wage.
The rest of us can't be perfect, you know, so.
Well, Idaho loves Mississippi, because if it wasn't for Mississippi, we'd be at the bottom of everything.
Oh, nice. Well, you know, it's good to have goals and aim high. Moving on along. Moving on up. the year 1901, the first Nobel Prizes are awarded.
Hooray, Nobel!
Yay! Well, actually, he was kind of an asshole.
who wasn't?
Yeah, but this guy's a special kind. So, 1901, let's go back for even further, though. Alfred Nobel was born in the year 1833 in Stockholm, Sweden, into a family of engineers. So, you know, already kind of upper class right there.
Mm-hmm.
He was a chemist, engineer, and inventor. In 1894, Nobel purchased an iron and steel mill, which he made into a major armaments manufacturer. He also invented bastalite, which was a precursor to many of the smokeless military explosives, especially cordite. Nobel amassed a fortune during his lifetime, with most of his wealth from his 355 inventions, of which dynamite is the most famous. So, yeah, he was a big arms dealer, essentially.
Yeah. War profiteer.
Yeah, although, that's a good one.
Although dynamite's been used for a lot of peaceful uses.
Sure, but smokeless powder, that's been mostly for making ammunition.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, here's a funny bit. In 1888, Nobel was astonished to read his own obituary, titled The Merchant of Death is Dead. Yeah, that was in a French newspaper. So it was actually Alfred's brother, Ludwig, who had died. But this error sent a shock to his system, of course. In fact, the article disconcerted Nobel so much that he became apprehensive about how he would be remembered. And this inspired him to change his will many times. On December 10th, 1896, Alfred Nobel did die in Italy from a cerebral hemorrhage. He was 63 years old. So anyways, getting back to that will. Yeah. To the widespread astonishment, Nobel's last will specified that his fortune be used to create a series of prizes for those who confer the, quote-unquote, the greatest benefit on mankind in areas of physics, chemistry, physiology, or medicine, literature, and, quote-unquote, peace, however you want to define that one. Nobel bequeathed 94% of his total assets, which was 31 million SEK, currently valued at $186 million in 2008. U.S., of course. And that was to establish the five Nobel Prizes. Because of skepticism around the will, it was not until 26 April 1897 that it was even approved by the Storting in Norway. Because that's a court system. So, anyways.
They're like, wait, are we talking about the same guy? You know him, right? Yeah, yeah, the guy was an asshole.
Yeah, right. War profiteer, you know. Yeah. Getting to the winners for the first one. Wilhelm Röntgen's discovery of X-rays in physics. There was also Jacobus van 't Hoff for contributions in chemical thermodynamics. The first prize for medicine went to German physiologist and microbiologist Emil von Behring, which during the 1890s, von Behring developed an antitoxin to treat diphtheria, which had, of course, been killing thousands every year before that. And there were even some dramas at the first Nobels. Man, Swedish Academy chose the poet Sully Prodholm for the first Nobel Prize in Literature, but a group including 42 Swedish writers, artists, and literary critics protested against this decision, having expected Leo Tolstoy to be awarded the prize. Dum, bum, bum. Drama.
Well, and one factor in why Norway would be involved with that, considering he was Swedish, is Sweden and Norway were one country at that time.
Yeah.
Ooh. Svorne.
The Swedish-Norwegian Union was what
Hello.
It was called.
Hello, Robus yeah. here, King of Sweden. and on my last one for this day is 2005. Richard Pryor, the American comedian and actor, producer, screenwriter, dies. So if you don't know Richard Pryor, fuck you need to go learn. he's interestingly totally fucking cool. Said he's still listed as the number one in Comedy Central's list of all-time greatest stand-up comedians.
Hmm.
He was definitely known for uncompromising examinations of racism, topical issues, and definitely wasn't afraid to swear and, you know, turn the heat up on anybody when they deserved it. Fucking loved him.
Yeah, I was introduced to Richard Pryor at a fairly early age when my mom's records were all laying out, and there she had quite a few of Richard Pryor records, and we're like, Mom, why do you have a bunch of Richard Pryor records? There was, I mean, the classics. That's where I first saw the word nigger.
Nice.
He loved to use that in particular. Yes. And she was like, oh, yeah, well, first divorce ended with him taking the Beatles and me being stuck with Richard Pryor. I'm like, oh.
Man, I would definitely take the Pryor over the Beatles.
No, she was in love with the Beatles. So not a friendly divorce, let's just say. A
bunch of skinny white boys.
Yeah, and I recently heard a rant on Angry Black Rant about the use of that particular word. And Ishmael would approve of the context.
I believe so. And Ishmael, if you're listening, yeah, once all that hype surrounding all that shit calms down a bit of you being on everybody else's fucking show, we'll have you on ours.
Yeah.
But I believe I was talking to you first about that shit before we got on everybody else's show. Just saying, fucker.
Just saying.
He does listen.
Yeah, we'll see.
He better.
We'll see.
We'll see if he responds. Yeah.
You old ass black motherfucker. I wanted you on our show before anybody else. Yeah. Calling you out. All right. Anyways, yeah.
All right. We're going to take another quick break and we'll be back with science. We love hearing from our listeners. You can email us at contact@atheistnomads.com, tweet us @atheistnomads, send us a message on our Facebook page at facebook.com/atheistnomads, or better yet, call us and leave us a message at 541-203-0666. We might even play it on the show. You can also help us out by leaving us a review on iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcast directory of choice. Tell you what, while you do science, I'll take Bucky outside.
All right. Awesome. Yay. That would be great. Because he wants that squeaky toy more than anything right now.
Great.
All right. So it's,
okay.
So now we are getting to science.
Wait, now it's just me and you, huh?
Uh-huh. Talking about science.
And Dustin's not here to stop us. He's not here to stop us.
The chemistry base. Actually, today is going to be more of a biology theme.
A biology theme?
Stop that.
Stop that.
Actually, I only have one article because with this time travel craziness that we're doing with this episode, I only had a week to look up science, new science articles instead of 2 weeks. So anyway, this is the one I found most interesting. Anybody who is anybody knows what a tardigrade is. Tardigrade is aka water bear, aka moss piglet.
So
is a very, very small little animal that lives in mosses all over the world. It is famous for its ability to survive extreme physical conditions. They have shot it into space. They have put it in like as low Kelvin as they can. They've put it into volcanoes. And this little moss piglet survives. The reason behind this, they believe, is because it has so much junk DNA, aka non-coding DNA, that there's backups for everything that's destroyed. So if it gets damaged, it can survive by repairing itself using extra DNA that's lying around in its genome. No, that's not actually how DNA works, but for this, we'll go ahead and say it. Anyway, recent discovery about tardigrades is that their genome has more foreign DNA in it than any other creature on Earth. So we're talking like every human has a cell that has a mitochondria. That mitochondria is foreign. It was probably eaten and then survived, and then it became to function within the cell, and that's how we have mitochondria. Well, the tardigrade basically did this on a massive scale, most likely with bacteria, and up to 17.5% of its own genetic makeup is not animal. It is either bacteria or fungal. There's some virus DNA thrown in there. It's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. So the theory behind how they were able to do this is they went to the one thing that does this on a regular basis, and that's bacteria. Bacteria has a process of swapping DNA with other living creatures through all sorts of means, mostly through a process called desiccation. It basically means there's damage done, there's an opening, some external DNA gets into the bacteria, and when it heals itself up, it decides to use that extra DNA for itself. They're little scavengers. Anyway, apparently tardigrades do the same thing. When they become severely dehydrated, they go into a suspended animation until water is reintroduced. Sometimes that can be quite a while, and there could be a lot of damage done to the outside of this poor little moss piglet. When it does come back into contact with water, it uses whatever DNA is around to help heal itself back up. Of course, bacteria is probably going to be the most common thing in water that the tardigrade is going to use. So then you get this cool little moss piglet water bear thing that has 17% DNA that's not even its own. It's bacterial, and it is really cool. In fact, if you add up the entire genome, 51% of the tardigrade's DNA is animal. The rest of that, 49%, is bacterial, viral, fungal, protozoan. It's just really crazy. And that is why the tardigrade is the most amazing creature in the world.
Ew.
So resilient. And I've recently learned how to grow one yourself. Basically, you just keep squeezing moss until you find one, typically under a microscope. And then you keep feeding it moss. So you too can have a pet tardigrade. I'm seriously considering doing this.
You go on with your bad self and have your icky little poo-shaped microscopic creature.
It's like a poo, but with leech teeth.
Yeah.
And cute little claws that
Nothing
it uses.
Cute about it.
Oh, it's adorable to eat the little moss. Oh my gosh. I love the picture that comes with this little how to raise your own tardigrade. It's just a picture of this girl staring at this petri dish with some moss on it. It's because you can't see it. They're too small. Anyway. So that's it for this week for science.
As a listener of the show, I'm going to assume you love my sexy vocal stylings. If you love the rest of the show as much as my voice, consider giving us the resources we desperately need to purchase quality cocaine and Red Bull. We make it super easy to make a one-time donation or to support us on a per-episode, monthly, or even annual basis using PayPal or Patreon. Find out more at atheistnomads.com. Use the links on the right side of the page. $1 an episode is all we ask.
Of course, we have to start off with the Colorado Springs Planned Parenthood shooting. So let's start off with a rundown of the event. At 11:38 a.m., Robert Louis Deer, dressed in hunting gear, started shooting.
He was dressed as a deer? No, wait. Okay,
His
sorry.
Last name is Deer. He was dressed in hunting gear.
I'm getting delirious.
The staff at the clinic moved the people out of the waiting room and locked a security door. When police arrived, he shot at them, thus starting a standoff that would end with his surrender at 4:52 p.m., more than 5 hours later. In the end, one police officer and two civilians, one an Iraq War veteran, the other a mother, were killed, and five police officers and four civilians were injured. He has now been charged with murder in the first degree and is being held without bond. Some, including Vicki Cowart, president of Planned Parenthood of the Rocky Mountains, Colorado Springs Mayor John Suthers, Colorado Governor John Hickenlooper, and Mike Huckabee, GOP presidential candidate, have called this an act of terrorism, and Attorney General Loretta Lynch has called it a crime against women. Terrorism is defined as the use of violence and intimidation in the pursuit of political aims. Sounds and the shooters, right. The shooter said, no more baby parts, and expressed other anti-abortion and anti-government sentiments during the police interview after his arrest.
Might I say he was expressing Republican and Christian sentiments right there?
Yeah, yeah.
Very conservative. Baby parts. Yes.
I mean, that's coming out directly out of the right wing.
That's
bullshit videos.
Out of the bullshit video.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Which I think only one TV station still even claims as a thing.
That'd be Fox.
Oh, the one that he watches religiously. Yeah, that one. Religiously.
Yeah. So, you know, if he actually shot the place for those political motivations, which it sure sounds like he did, then yes, this was terrorism.
A right-wing Republican Christian terrorist. That's what I'm calling him.
This is kind of like when they kept saying, Barack Hussein Obama, you're just going to keep saying that thing no matter what.
Yeah.
Like, nope, it's the full title or it's no title at all.
Well, we covered a story a while back on how much domestic, usually Christian conservative terrorism there has been in the U.S. in the last, I think it was looking at the last 20 years. It's a lot more than Islamic terrorism.
It's really disheartening.
Yeah, it tends to be smaller, unless it's Timothy McVeigh, but holy crap. And this was a big enough deal that several Planned Parenthood clinics have additional police security to help them keep open and feeling safe because they're afraid they're going to get shot up too. And what's the whole point of terrorism? It's to make people scared.
Hey, you know what? I don't see any of those Oath Keepers around now. Where are they at?
Would you want them there?
No, but still, those motherfuckers, they're not even offering. Why? Because, Deere is doing the work that they want all these people to do.
Yeah.
They approve of Deere's actions. I'll bet you a buck.
Well, apparently a lot of people approved of it.
Twitter was disgusting.
Exploded. Twitter, Facebook, social media of all kinds. Where we kind of segregate ourselves into these little, you know, preaching to the choir segments of humanity. So you forget that there's the majority of people out there aren't the same as you and your friends.
Yeah.
You think that everybody went out and voted because all of your friends have the little pictures of the I voted sticker. And then you find out 13% voted. You're like, what? Who are all these other people? They're the others, and the others are bad.
Yeah.
Gotta say, there was a bright spot in that. Kerry Stewart, he was a 29-year-old Iraq war vet. Deere actually shot him, and the dude ran back into the clinic to warn others. You know, he knew he was going to die, but, you know, he tried to help others in his last moments. So, I mean,
good
badass.
For him.
Good for him, man.
So, I just poured my second glass of... And by glass, I mean pint. Almost a pint.
They come in pints.
No, the bottle is a lot bigger than a pint.
Oh, this bottle is.
It's a 22-ounce bottle. I love good, strong beer. Beer with the alcohol of wine, but it's beer.
Should we move on to the cruise?
Best of both worlds. Oh, anyway, yeah. So, So speaking of those others, like the GOP presidential candidates, Trump, Fiorina, and Cruz have all condemned the violence.
That's a baby step.
No, Huckabee as well.
I believe a couple of them blamed it on liberals.
We'll get to that.
I believe that was Fiorina and Huckabee that did that.
And Cruz as well. But after condemning the violence, they all asserted that the anti-abortion rhetoric that they have been spewing couldn't possibly have been a factor. Some even went as far as to say that the videos claiming the fraudulent videos claiming that Planned Parenthood is selling body parts, that couldn't have been a factor.
No.
And then they went on to talk about Planned Parenthood selling body parts.
Obviously.
Or excuse me, baby parts.
Yeah.
Quote unquote. But Ted Cruz was the most creative. The audio I have from the Texas Tribune is pretty poor quality, but I have cleaned it up the best I can. So let's hear what he had to say.
We don't fully know the motivations of this deranged individual. We know that he was a man who registered to vote as a woman. And the media promptly wants to blame him on the pro-life movement when, at this point, there's very little evidence to indicate.
What was reported, he said no more baby as he was apprehended.
Well, it's also reported that he was registered as an independent and as a woman and a transgender leftist activist, if that's what he is. I don't think it's fair to blame on the rhetoric of the left. This is a murderer.
So in case you missed that, a reporter asked him about the statement he made of no more baby parts. And Cruz's response was that it's also been reported that he is a leftist transgendered activist.
Yeah, okay.
Have you seen his picture? I don't think he's transgendering.
Probably not, but he's... Yeah, this is pretty crazy.
I mean, it is true that you can be liberal, you can be leftist, you can be Democrat, and still be, still believe that conception is where life starts. That happens, and that's not abnormal. It's the taking a gun down to the place and shooting people who are not related to anything that you are against at all. That's what's bad. That's what's crazy.
Well, if you heard that there was someone in your community who was taking babies, killing them, and chopping them up and selling their body parts, and the government was okay with it, and the police weren't going to do anything about it, most people would want to do something about that. You can't do that to babies. These people, the only thing that is really wrong with them is they have the wrong idea of what a baby is.
Well, they have a different view of what a baby is. Just to be devil's advocate here. That, I mean, there is a lot of people out there, every Catholic, for example, who believes that you know, a two-celled organism that is the result of a man and a woman laying together biblically is life, and that is a baby.
Now,
I'm going to stick with the loose definition that if it can survive outside of the womb, even with intensive care, then it's a baby.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
where I draw the line as well.
That's where most people draw the line. If it can, you know, even one person brought up.
Survivability.
Yeah, survivability. Well, which has been expanded now with healthcare. I mean, you can have a baby at 27 weeks now and it could actually survive. But until that baby is separated from mommy, it is not a baby. It's technically a fetus.
Yeah. It's a baby when you have a choice between an abortion and a C-section.
Yes. Oh, that's a good way to put it.
Until then, it's a tumor.
Ew. But yes.
You know, and as far as the Catholic view, they lose all credibility with their view on end-of-life care. They believe that you are alive and it is a sin to do anything to interfere with that, even if that means ending the interference they are doing with your death. And that is insane. I think it is perfectly reasonable that if you cannot survive without the assistance of machines, you're dead.
Now, if they could come up with a cyborg fetus...
You know, I have spent a few years back, I got to spend 3 days in the ICU with a corpse on machines. That was my nephew. It was the craziest shit in the world to go through that experience of witnessing that. And no, he was not alive. The machines may have said he was. That was all the work of the machines. And anybody who would say, No, that's somebody who's alive. No, that's crazy. That's delusional. That's a warm corpse. A fetus that isn't viable outside of the womb isn't really any different, just on the other end of things. And when it comes down to it, what's right and wrong about when life begins and ends, that's not a It really shouldn't be a philosophical decision. That's something that can be answered scientifically. Yeah, there's a gray area there. There's a fuzzy line. But the people who think there's this really hard line that is way outside of the realm of reasonable, they're wrong. And I have no problem saying they are flat out wrong. Now, it's debatable about whether or not the Republican presidential candidates have been inciting violence.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever started the video for the Planned Parenthood, you know, did that creative editing to make it look like they're callously selling off parts they've harvested.
Yeah.
That is somebody who I would say is culpable.
Somebody should fucking face some charges.
That's for sure. Those are people who were, yeah, they had a political motive they were trying to accomplish with that. That turned into people dying. And a great example of some of the language around that is Josh Feuerstein, who in July had some words to be said after watching those videos. And I will play for that for you now. And if you try to go back and look for the original video, it's gone. If anything he says, it ends up being controversial that our side takes notice of, he deletes it. So you have to try to find it from another source. And I only got a little bit of it, but here's what he said.
We punish Planned Parenthood. I think it's time that abortion doctors should have to run and hide and be afraid for their life.
Making people run and hide, afraid for their lives, that's
making abortion doctors pay. Right. Okay.
So what he was saying, basically, what they needed to do was go out and kill a couple of them so the rest would be scared. That's flat out terrorism, pure and simple.
Not to mention all the other bombings and murders and killings and threats against other abortion doctors and Planned Parenthood and clinics all over the United States. It's been going on for years and years and years that everybody's just been passively ignoring.
Yeah, I think there's been something like, what, 4 fires at Planned Parenthood clinics this year alone?
I know there was a knife attack not too long ago.
And Planned Parenthood does, like, what, 3% of their clinic's job is abortions? Why are you punishing all of these people who are just trying to get some birth control or just trying to get their boobs checked out so they don't have cancer?
Pap smears and like...
Hoo-haws, damn it. We want healthy hoo-haws.
Yeah. The STI screenings. Yeah. That's a huge part of what they do is checking people for diseases.
But nope, shoot them all. Make them run and hide. Yeah, so yeah, you can tell we're a little upset about this.
Now, for Feuerstein, there is a WhiteHouse.gov petition to have him brought up on charges. I have signed it. Yep. I encourage all of you to sign it.
Will it happen? Fuck no. But the dude needs to get smacked down.
Yeah, and this is a petition I would like to see the White House answer. If it gets to 100,000 signatures within a month, they are obligated to respond in writing.
The dude is inciting violence and death and murder.
Well, like, not only that, but there does need to be kind of a line drawn where freedom of speech and yelling fire and yelling to go kill people, you know, where there needs to be a line drawn there somewhere. It's and this is good precedence for that.
Supreme Court's drawn that line a few times.
Well, it keeps getting brought up, though. I mean, obviously... I mean, the fire one is obvious.
It's basically just that people aren't willing to do a thing about it.
Yeah.
But this isn't his first video that he talks about stuff like this.
Oh, no.
So.
No, I mean, he's up in arms about everything. It's what he does. He's a social media.
Asshole.
Evangelist.
Yeah. That's what
with 2 million followers.
2 million. And who are more than happy to send him money and retweet his stuff. I mean, obviously. He's allowed to say this stuff. That's fine. But when people act on it, the problem is we can't prove that the guy who shot up Planned Parenthood listened to his thing and said, "This guy is right. I'm going to go do that." Until you can prove that link, there's no case.
Yeah.
The guy's just an asshole, and assholes get what they get. And believe me, once his information was released out on 4chan, and I'm seriously, they'll make his life a living hell.
Well, I can sure hope, at least.
All right, let's go ahead and move on to the next story.
All right.
While Saudi Arabia may pardon Raif Badawi, they are going to execute Ashraf Fayada, a 35-year-old Palestinian poet, for apostasy. And this has prompted a lot of condemnation, including one tweet that got their attention. Saudi Arabia's attention, that is. According to a Justice Ministry source, the Justice Ministry will sue the person who described the sentencing of a man to death for apostasy as being ISIS-like. Questioning the fairness of the courts is to question the justice of the kingdom and its judicial system based on Islamic law, which guarantees rights and ensures human dignity.
Only some human dignity.
If you question the courts, I mean, you're automatically questioning the religion. So I can see where this, I can see where he got the sentence.
How is that guaranteeing rights and human dignity when?
Oh, it's not.
You execute someone for apostasy. That is insane. And it's what ISIS would do. And following in Sam Mulvey's example, I'm actually going to be tweeting the Saudi embassy, comparing them to ISIS.
Nice.
Right now, while we're recording. I need a
friend of the show, Sam Mulvey from Ask an Atheist.
Saudi embassy. There we go. Saudi at Saudi Embassy USA. Executing someone for apostasy is what ISIS would do. Hashtag LOL suit.
Hashtag Saudi ISIS. Hashtag Saudi is ISIS. But that would just be like Saudi ISIS.
Hashtag Saudi. Hashtag ISIS.
Hashtag not the one from Archer.
Hashtag, yup.
Hashtag, okay.
This is how you get ants. Do you want ants?
Oh, I'm going with that. Okay, so the tweet reads, at Saudi Embassy USA, executing someone for apostasy is what ISIS would do. Hashtag LOL suit. Hashtag Saudi. Hashtag ISIS. Hashtag not the one from Archer. Hashtag this is how you get ants. 7 characters remaining.
Nice.
Fuck yeah.
That's good very job. Nice. Good use of hashtag. Which tweeting. Is stupid, by the way, Twitter people. God.
Hashtags is how you can follow stories.
No, hashtags that people just make up, hoping that it'll catch on or they think that they're funny.
Sometimes they do. Used. LOL suit is actually getting used.
Well, so is Roar Bacon. But there are some that's just...
On November 23, Yahya Jammeh, President of the Gambia, announced that female genital mutilation will be banned and it will have immediate effect.
Sweet.
It is not known when he will actually be banning it or when the legislation will come to actually enforce this ban. But this is a very important move considering that this is a country where 76% of women have been subjected to the barbaric practice.
Holy fuck.
Just their way of becoming women.
Oh, there's a growing trend for infants.
Let's sew their pussy shut.
What?
Yeah.
Poor little babies.
Infants.
I mean, poor adults. Ooh, that's... It's all bad.
Mm-hmm. Hashtag, leave the hoo-has alone.
I know, I wish there was a, hashtag catch up with the rest of the world, goddammit. But no, that's Gambia, that's Nigeria, there's a couple big names there that have banned this. Now we just got to get to the part where they enforce it.
Now we get because that's the problem. Have to get down to the neighborhood level and actually enforce that shit.
Yeah, once you get, and it's unfortunate that it's still going on incredibly widespread because they live 20 miles outside of town, so they can do whatever they want.
Shit, they live in town.
18 countries in Africa have already banned this practice.
That's great. Yeah. Now we need a squad of police to like fucking go out and, or just fucking take all their kids away until they're like, 2 or something. I don't know, stupid shit, but still.
To stop something like this, it has to start with some very high-profile criminal cases.
You got to change the minds of the families.
And it starts with the high-profile criminal cases. Mm. It gets people's attention, and over the course of, unfortunately, decades, people will come around.
So we basically have to find out who the Gambian version of the Kardashians is.
Now,
and then
so
have them get convicted.
That's one approach. The other approach that would be less likely to actually be able to happen in a country like this,
hashtag,
but would be Gambian more effective, Kardashian. Give women more power, give them some education, and once women there have those two things, they won't let their daughters have done to them what was done to them.
Yeah. I mean, they hope anyway.
Give the women education, hope, rights.
Yeah.
Education is still a far way away, but we can at least start by not mutilating your babies.
Somalia is where it's the worst. 98% of girls between 4 and 11.
Ugh.
Well, obviously, by the time they're 11, they're already getting pregnant, so you got to get them before that.
Yeah. Ugh. Holy shit. And we're going to end on a... I don't know if this one's funny or infuriating or both.
It's just it's sad. Both.
In Harris County, Georgia, Sheriff Mike Jolly, or Jolly, or I'm going to go with Jolly, put up a sign in front of his office. That is the sheriff's office that says, "Warning, Harris County is politically incorrect. We say Merry Christmas, God bless America, and in God we trust. We salute our troops and our flag. If this offends you, leave." He says that he's tired of the majority being silent, and when asked about how non-Christian employees might feel, he said, "They're more than welcome to worship whatever God they choose fit. For me and mine, we worship Jesus Christ."
Yeah, the guy's just fucking lame.
It's just like the sheriffs that want to put "In God We Trust" on all the... The problem is that it went up. So, the sign is there. That's what shouldn't have happened.
You know, this is... I'm not sure if this is better or worse than the... I would say this is actually a lot worse than the "In God We Trust" on cop cars, because this is a sign. It's saying that they're cool with being politically incorrect. They're saying if you're offended by any of that, to leave the county, and it is on the sheriff's department's property in front of the sheriff's office. That's not his personal office. That is a government building.
Yeah.
I love that. On this sign, I mean, there is a horrible mistake. It says, "We say Merry Christmas, comma, God bless America, and in God we trust."
Some people choose to not use the Oxford comma.
And they are wrong.
And they're completely wrong. And also, judging by the capitalization, they're missing a period also. Or at least another comma. This is just a horribly grammatically wrong sign. Just like the guy that's standing right next to it. The sheriff.
The sheriff. Yeah.
Well, he's got ellipses.
Well,
on
the
a government
grammar doesn't
sign.
Matter, okay, people?
Okay,
the grammar's
yeah, sorry.
Not the point.
What? Sorry, grammar's
sorry.
Always the point. Grammar Nazi.
This is
hashtag grammar Nazi.
So inappropriate on so many levels. Let's even just ignoring the details of the sign, his intent is grotesque. He is taking it upon himself to speak on behalf of the silent majority in his county. You know what? You cannot speak for a silent majority. You know why? They're fucking silent. They didn't tell you what to say. And when asked about how his employees would feel, he said they're welcome to worship whatever God they choose. Well, the biggest group of people who don't worship Jesus Christ don't worship any God. So do they need to leave?
Don't ask him that. He will fire them.
And get his ass sued.
I would like to mention that just a month earlier, he did have stickers put on all 30 Harris County Sheriff's Office vehicles saying "In God We Trust."
Yeah, we've got a county up in Idaho. Northern Idaho's done the same thing. And nobody's, I don't know, what do you do? ACLU involved? drag it out for 2 years, 3 years, while the sign just sits there. Hope that somebody runs it over. Vandalism, unfortunately.
Try to get out of a speeding ticket because the cop car endorsed religion.
I don't think that would get you
the car that pulled you over. Technicality.
Dude,
I got out of a ticket because the officer wrote the wrong date. Judge just threw it out off of a phone call.
Didn't you get out of a ticket by having your cleric stuff on you too?
Sometimes.
So isn't that like the backwards version of this?
Jolly definitely isn't backing down. If anything, he's doubling down, though. He did have a quote here saying, "I do believe if it truly offends you, maybe you are in the wrong place." But he also said if ordered to, he would take the sign down.
Yeah, so it needs to be somebody from in that county, in that town, who needs to go up to him and say, you know, it's not just these reporters from out of town. This hurts me. This hurts my family.
Well, there's just somebody
and
in
what
that
do you
town
have
that
against
needs
us?
To make... Well, somebody in that town needs to at least make an anonymous report to FFRF, and they'll send out a letter. And...
Well, what'd be the best would be for a judge there
that'd to be
say,
nice too.
Dude, this isn't right. Put it in your own yard.
Jolly paid $553 for the sign out of his own pocket. But, of course, those who agree with his sentiments have been showing their own support through their checkbooks. And more than $1,000 in small donations came in Monday from Illinois to Colorado, Florida, all these other places. So, yeah.
That's because what he put up has basically been a really bad bumper sticker for about 20 years. And those are all the people that have that bumper sticker.
Ah, man.
You know what? Fine. Fuck it. Leave the In God We Trust stickers on the vehicles, but I want to see some atheists. I want to see some Satanists. I want to see some Buddhist stickers all up on that shit, too. Fuck it.
Well, the problem with In God We Trust...
The cop car is going to look like fucking NASCARs when I'm done with it.
The problem with God and Trust is it has special privilege under the guise of ceremonial deism, even when that's not the intent of putting it up. And because it's patriotic ceremonial deism, nothing else has to get equal footing with that.
Whatever. He's a fucking hick, and he just, you know, doesn't understand that he's like in the majority, and fuckers aren't silent. And
yeah, far from silent.
Well, typically people like that just lack empathy. They don't understand that there are other people around them who aren't in that majority. And until somebody comes up and gives them a real personal story about, hey, this is why we don't do this. It's just like in high school, my friends used to say retarded all the time until that one person said, what the hell, guys? My brother's retarded. That's not cool. And we're like, oh, sorry. We didn't realize that was okay. We'll stop saying it. You need to have a personal connection in order to strike up some sympathy. Otherwise, they don't care. It's more media attention. It's more money in his pocket.
Well, he did say he was going to donate the money, but still, fuck.
Yeah. Well,
at least that's nice. All right. Fuck.
All right, I wanted to go back to the Planned Parenthood guy real quick.
Oh, okay.
Some more information about his personal life has been released.
Oh, nice.
Including interviews with his ex-wives. Yes, he had several, who all left because of the physical, emotional, and verbal abuse that he gave them.
Yeah.
He's been basically arrested and repeatedly dismissed for over 20 years for multiple charges. So this is a guy who's been in the system for beating people, for beating animals, for peeping Toms, for stalking, for all this stuff, and we just now hear about the guy getting arrested. It could have been anything that set this guy off.
Yeah, if you didn't say peeping Tom, I was gonna enjoy it.
arrested on cruelty to animals charge in 2003, but found not guilty in 2004. It was peeping Tom in 2002, but that was dismissed. Ex-wife called police after getting beaten, but like the other rape victim, she declined to press charges. So there's just this guy who's just been going around abusing especially women and been getting away with it. And so he finally snapped and shot people.
And since none of those actually, sounds like none of them even went to trial.
Nope.
He's got a squeaky clean record.
Yeah, he is. Absolutely. The what was it? One article, quote unquote.
Privilege, privilege is showing.
They
keep on letting him off.
Yeah, he was quoted as being the gentle loner who would sometimes have explosions of violence. It's like, no, if he can't be a gentle loner and have explosive violence in the same thing. That is somebody who needs to be looked after and has I hate to pull the mental health card again, but if this guy had been on some serious medication, maybe this wouldn't have happened.
The other crazy thing, I'm just going to toss this out here. You know, the other gentle loner that lived in a cabin out in the woods, Theodore Ted Kaczynski.
Yeah.
Unabomber.
Only apparently he was a lot more charismatic than this guy.
Well, and you know, I've said the issue isn't that people with mental health issues shouldn't be able to have guns. It's that there are certain profiles that would suggest that people should not have access to guns. This guy sure sounds like he fits that profile.
Well, what really cinched it for me on this article was, according to the ex-wife, as long as he's saved, he can do whatever he pleases.
Well, yeah.
That is a dangerous mentality.
Mm-hmm. Once saved, always saved.
Yeah, so
the most dangerous thing that came out of the Protestant Reformation.
And he's just waiting for the world to end, so it doesn't matter. That's going to happen any day now, so whatever. You know, wow. If the end of the world is going to happen within this lifetime, why are people so obsessed with saving fetuses?
Got to get more souls in heaven.
But weren't...
Even though they already have souls because those come at conception.
Yeah, come.
Anyway, we are out of time, and we don't have any feedback, and we don't have any new supporters.
Hasn't been long enough. Come on, people.
Yeah, we need...
Give us some feedback.
And support.
And support, because we didn't move to Seattle, so... And we live in Idaho. Come on. I'm joking.
All right. Well, next week, we'll be back with an interview.
Thank you for listening to another episode of Atheist Nomads. You can find show notes and contact information at atheistnomads.com. Follow us on Twitter at Atheist Nomads and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/atheistnomads. Please subscribe to the show in iTunes, Stitcher, or your podcatcher of choice. And while you're there, feel free to leave us a review. Theme music is courtesy of Sturdy Fred. Until next time, this has been the Atheist Nomads.
If you donate enough money, I can open a bar and call it the Heinous Anus.
Sold.
Wow. Right. Okay, so.
I guess that's going at the end of the show too, huh?